This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. I have two amazing guests on this Thriving Dentist Show, my great friends, Dr. Mark Montgomery and Dee Dee Reid. And we are going to talk about how to implement airway dentistry in your practice. You know, such an important topic. We're learning so much about how restricted airway affects the health of our patients. And Mark and Dee Dee are authorities on this topic, and they have some amazing information to share with you on how to successfully implement airway dentistry. You're going to enjoy this interview. Hey, I have an announcement to make. You know, I've been spending a lot of time speaking and working with clients on the area of reducing insurance dependency. You know, this is a passion of mine, and I've made the decision to launch a second podcast. It's called the Less Insurance Dependence Podcast. I partnered with my friend, Nedan Aruluja. Nedan is the founder of the digital marketing agency that we use at Life Smiles called Equa, E-K-W-A. And each week, Nedan and I will provide a shorter podcast. These podcasts will be about 15 minutes in length and all about reducing insurance dependency in your practice. I'd like to encourage you to subscribe to that podcast, to listen to it. Of course, if you like Thriving Dentist Show, I think you're really going to like the Less Insurance Dependence podcast. You can find that on the website, lessinsurancedependence.com. I'll put that in the show notes, but you can find that. I'd encourage you to jump over there and subscribe, and I think you'll really enjoy what we have to share with you regarding how to successfully reduce insurance dependence in your practice. Now, before we get to the interview with Mark and Dee Dee, we have another edition of Top Clinical Tips with Dr. Leanne Brady. This top clinical tip is all about how to take an effective stick bite to avoid the most common mistakes with aesthetic dentistry. Lee's going to share with you how to do this very easily, very efficiently, how to take an effective stick bite. Here's that top clinical tip with Dr. Leanne Brady.
So for today's top clinical tip, I want to talk about taking a stick bite. And a stick bite is honestly one of the quickest, easiest things you can do in your practice to really make sure that your anterior aesthetics with a laboratory comes out the way you want it, and to overcome the most common but the most deadly mistake in aesthetic dentistry. And yet I'm going to tell you, most people I know don't send stick bites to the laboratory. So what's the most commonly noticed and most deadly aesthetic mistake? It's creating a cant to the contact between the upper central incisors. And so we call that a midline cant or a midline inclination. And patients are super sensitive to that. They actually notice when it's off as much as 1 degree, which is tiny. And as soon as they notice it, of course, they start focusing in on it. And then they notice everything else that's not quite right about the veneers or the crowns. So that midline, if the patient is standing up straight in the world, their eyes level to the horizon, their midline has to be straight up and down 90 degrees to the horizon. Why is it so darn easy to screw up? Because we never look at our patients from that perspective. We're always with the patient leaning back in the chair at some degree of angle. And if you're a right-handed dentist, you're on their right side. And if you're a left-handed dentist, you're on the left side. And so when we create straight up and down, we do it to our bodies as the reference point, and we create a cant in the patient's mouth. So the reason we screw it up is our perspective is not correct. And we could talk more about how do you sit when you prep upper anterior teeth. But let's talk laboratory communication. The easiest way to not get that cant when you get veneers back or crowns back is to send the laboratory a stick bite. So how are you going to do a stick bite? You're going to sit the patient up. I actually often put them in my provider chair. So I sit them in my dentist chair and I actually slide them so their back is against the windows in my office where my mini blinds are, because they're, I'm assuming the guy hung them with a level. So when I open them, they're level. And I take literally a Benda brush, inexpensive plastic Benda brush, and I'm going to take bite registration. I ask them to open a little bit, put bite reg on their lower front teeth. I ask them to close just enough that their upper teeth touch the bite silicone. I take my Benda brush, I stick it in the bite silicone, and then I look at the mini blinds and make sure it's level to the horizon. And then I take more bite registration and I cover the Benda brush, let the whole thing set for 30 seconds, have them pop their teeth apart. And now this Benda brush that's got this little area of bite silicone with tooth marks in it in the middle goes in the box to the laboratory. What does the laboratory do with that? They actually put it on the mounted models that you sent them, and they now have a reference to horizon. So now any discrepancy that was introduced because your face bow wasn't completely level, or your DFA, if you use a DFA, wasn't completely level, or you thought it was level, but the patient had their head cocked a little bit, so the truth is it's not level. All of that gets corrected, and the laboratory can see horizon. They can just correct the mounted models on the articulator and make sure you don't get the deadly midline cant.
I mentioned in the intro that my guests on this Thriving Dentist Show are two amazing friends of mine, Dee Dee Reid and Dr. Mark Montgomery. Hey, Dee Dee. Hey, Mark. How are you guys?
Hello, Gary. How are you? Honored to be with you today.
Man, such a treat. You know, I've said before, Mark, that one of the things I love about doing this podcast is that I get to talk to cool people like you and Dee Dee. This is just fun.
We love hanging out with you, Gary.
Well, it's mutual. And hey, let's tell them what we're going to talk about, because I could hardly think about a more important topic. We're going to talk about implementing airway dentistry. How cool is that?
Yes. It's kind of our favorite topic right now.
You know, I've often said that, dentistry rocks, and you've heard me say that, Mark and Dee Dee. And the reason I say dentistry rocks is we get the opportunity to change people's lives every day. And for our listeners, don't ever take that for granted, man. We get the opportunity to literally change people's lives every day. But this topic has perhaps even more profound possibility, and that's that we may have an opportunity to actually save someone's life. Am I reaching for it to say that, Mark?
I would say that that's not a reach at all, and that as we think about all of the things that go along with airway dentistry, that it's even more profound than saving someone's life. I think it's more to the point where we can not just save individual patients' lives, but we can make an impact in our community and even nationally as a profession in the whole health of our country. So I'm very big on this. And if you have any questions about how big I want to go, I can go there with you. But I think the first place I want to start is that there are so many comorbidities, so many chronic problems that are associated with airway issues. Mm-hmm. Everything from little kids who aren't sleeping to adult women who have fatal heart attacks, to who are in their 40s or 50s, even if they're not obese. Mm-hmm. And we think about the airway and we think about obesity and obstructive sleep apnea, but this is becoming a very, very big deal.
You're absolutely right, Mark. And, you've shared so much of this, you and Dee Dee have shared so much of this with me that it's almost like I feel like we in dentistry are like putting a detective cap on, right? Like a Sherlock Holmes cap. And yeah. It's like we're now discovering how many issues are interrelated. And much of this has to do with the airway. And it's something that I think has been on the fringe in the past in our profession. And it's really coming to the forefront thanks to pioneers like yourself and others that are really pioneering this. And, you know, it's almost we've all heard that saying that you go out and buy a red car and what happens?
Then you see all the red cars.
All you see is red cars, right? And yes. It's almost like, you know, you, and Mark, you've taught me this with occlusion. I'm going to credential you guys in just a minute, but we're having too much fun to get to the credentials. I'll get to those. But, you know, it's almost like, Mark, when the amazing work you've done with occlusion education. I remember this, I sent a long time client of mine, to take your course on practical occlusion. And he called me three times from the course, literally called me three times to thank me for sending him to the course.
Aww.
This is John Sullivan. You'll remember John. And, he said, the only regret I have, Gary, is that I didn't know this stuff 25 years ago. I said, well, don't beat yourself up. You know it now. You know, you know it now.
When we know better, we do better, right?
Yes, exactly. And I feel it's the same way with the topic of airway. It's like, yeah, I wish we would have known this stuff. You know, I've been in dentistry 38 years, you know, and I wish we knew this stuff a long time ago. Well, the great news is we know it now. Well, hey, can I take a minute just in case any of our listeners have been in a cave and they don't know who you guys are? Can I credential you guys for just a minute?
Sure.
Okay. I'm going to start with Mark. So, you know, I could actually read all of your credentials, but it would probably take the entire podcast time. And I don't think you would appreciate that, Mark. I'm just going to tell everyone that you are one of the most amazing educators in dentistry. You have the unique skill set of taking a very complex topic and actually distilling it into simple principles that make sense that you can use in your practice tomorrow. Hey, Mark, how was that for an introduction?
I like that.
Will that work?
That is on point.
Did I tell the truth?
Yes.
You know, I of course, I'm not a clinician, but, you know, I've sat through my share of occlusion lectures, right? And most of the time I'm scratching my head, you know, saying, well, when in the heck are these people ever going to use this stuff in their practice? And then I remember sitting in one of your occlusion courses and thinking, ding, 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 ding. This makes perfect sense.
Was it one of the ones where I handed out M&Ms and Tootsie Rolls?
It was. And I learned the difference between, well, I'll let you go ahead and tell the punchline, but you taught that there are two kinds of chewers in the world. Am I remembering? Vaguely.
Vaguely, which I don't remember the exact reference here. So,
but one was a cow, and how a cow chews, right? And I believe the other was how a carnivore chews. But anyway, yes. It was enlightening. It was like the light bulb was going off in my head. But anyway, Mark truly is one of the most gifted educators in dentistry. It's just an honor to have you on the show, Mark. Hey, and as cool as Mark is, Dee Dee's got some amazing credentials too. You were named one of the top 25 women in dentistry, and deservedly so. And what I love about Dee Dee is that she's a change agent. She has a tremendous gift at implementing changes in practices in a way that are embraced by doctor and team members. Dee Dee, did I tell the truth?
Well, yes, that's the fun stuff. I call it, I just go and make new friends every day.
Well, you do it well. Yeah. You do it very, very, very well. And I love the influence you've had on our amazing profession and the way your coaching and teaching style is embraced by team members. It's cool. It's cool to see.
Yeah, she calls it relationship-centered dentistry. Mm. She starts with her, she says friendships, but she starts with her relationships with the doctors and the team members, and everybody just comes on board. I don't know why, but everybody tells all their secrets to Dee Dee. She's got a way of empathizing and opening people up that is so powerful in moving forward.
Well, and actually in your skills, Dee Dee, can be used by dentists in terms of communicating with patients, you know, in terms of having the patient open up and actually listening. You're a master at the art and skill of listening. My grandmother taught me, Mark, that I was given two ears and one mouth for a reason. And that's it. I should listen twice as much as I talk. You're a great listener, Dee Dee. Anyway, we're going to have a blast on today's show. Hey, so Mark, I want to start with, you know, you and I have known each other for a long time. I lost track, but it's got to be 25 years. Does that sound about right?
That sounds about right.
Yeah. You know, and you know, from our early days of getting together, a lot of things, you know, haven't changed much. You know, we're still as excited as ever about cosmetic dentistry. We're excited about blending, function, and aesthetics together, and they actually can be, you know, developed together. We're excited about, you know, patients and occlusion, you know, but there's a lot of new things, and there's a lot of things that are changing fast now. Could you highlight some of those?
Well, you know, over my career, it's been, you know, from the time when we didn't even have a computer in the front desk, you know, now everything's computerized. We've got data analytics for everything we do in the practice. We have computerized tomography for our x-rays, and we've got this amazing systems of implants, and now patients, they don't have to ask for whitening and white teeth because everybody just expects straight white teeth. It's not something they choose anymore. It's just something that's expected, which is a huge difference from 35 years ago. But, you know, the other big change in our society is how many of our patients are suffering from chronic disease. And I've spent the last 10 to 20 years, well, 10 to 15 years, really honing in on how we deal with chronic pain in dentistry, with headaches and that, and also with what is going on with the patient's neurological system that and their airway system that causes them to have some of these sleep-related breathing disorders. And it's just become so prevalent in our society that I don't think we could walk into any dental practice today and just see healthy patient after healthy patient after healthy patient. It's just, they're just not there.
Right. Well,
and so I think the huge thing for us as dentists is how are we going to address that? Should we address it? Are we going to do the detective work that is necessary to integrate our thinking about their neurophysiology, their pain physiology, their breathing physiology with the metabolic manifestations that we see in the patients who are in our office.
You know, Mark, you and I have another number of things in common besides being follically challenged. I like that description. Is that a fair description, Mark?
Yeah, I buy that. It's just on the top of my head, though.
That's right. But you graduated from OHSU in 1980, and I started in this profession in 1980. So we had similar starting points. And, you know, we have a wide cross-section of listeners, not only geographically, we've got them in 170 countries, but also age-wise. Everything from pre-dental students all the way to very senior practitioners, including an email that I received the other day from an 88-year-old listener, practicing dentist, who practices 3 days a week and loves it. But anyway, what I was trying to get at was you glanced on something earlier that if you're a dentist of a certain age, you were taught that patients with airway issues looked a certain way. And in reality, we've really learned that the old myths about that are not accurate. That there's many other people that would be outside of the traditional risk group.
That's for sure. That we talk a lot about skinny woman syndrome, and because they're tiny, so is their airway. And typically, the women that are suffering here have upper airway resistance syndrome, which leads to a lot of metabolic disorders and non-sleeping, high anxiety and depression. So, you know, it is, they're not the typical you know, obese, big neck, you know, stereotype.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, I love the way that, Dee Dee, that you and Mark teach together on this, because, you know, Mark teaches a brilliant foundation of the clinical concepts, and then you then show your audiences and your clients how to actually implement this stuff in the practice. And they're really changing systems, right? They're not systems that have probably been in place before. We're having to create those. And especially in the area of airway dentistry, because of the fact that, you know, the morbidity discussion that we had earlier, as you learn this stuff, you start to realize that we need to do some screening with virtually every patient that comes through the door.
We definitely do. And, you know, change is something that is not easy. Yeah, but it's inevitable.
I would even go as far as to say that for many, it's painful.
Yes.
And yes. I mean that in a sensitive way, because the easy thing to do is to resist it, right?
Yes, and resistance is probably the first state of being that people have when they hear that we're going to be making some changes, and then it's, you know, having the awareness. You know, how is it going to affect me? And what is, you know, what is my role and contribution here? And, you know, is it going to upset my normal way of doing things? And, you know, how confident am I going to feel in this new system? Because I know for myself, I'm a perfectionist and I like to be good at everything. And when you start something new, it's not, you're not super great at it at first, and it feels awkward and it feels weird. And what's cool is patients don't know what's going on internally for us, which is good. But you know, as a change agent, our job is to enroll our team in having awareness of the why are these things important, and then motivating the desire to change so that we can take care of more people in a more comprehensive way. Most dental teams don't have the same awarenesses as the doctor because of their high education commitment. And the confidence level isn't always easy because they, you know, it's new.
Right.
And then, you know, history is not always a fun thing, because if change hasn't always worked out really great in the past, well, why the heck would we want to be doing more of that?
I have a fun reference point to the resistance, though. And I think Mark and Dee Dee, you'll appreciate this, because the three of us share a passion and interest in fitness and health. I have a fun reference to resistance. You know, when you're at the gym and you're lifting weights, if there's no resistance when you're lifting weights, nothing's happening, right? Mm-hmm. But when there's the resistance, you know, you're getting muscle growth. And the same thing true, the doctors, when you're feeling resistance to something, what you really need to do is to push through that, because you're experiencing growth. It could be intellectual growth, but you're experiencing growth. So think of that in the gym context, that if you're lifting something, there's no resistance, nothing's happening. But if you're getting some resistance, that means there's growth occurring. And I'd like to think that anybody listening to this podcast is into growth, or they wouldn't bother. You know, they wouldn't bother being listening to this. So maybe that's a positive context to think of resistance. And Dee Dee, I am so happy you made the reference to perfectionism, because I think a fair statement is that many of us, and I'm throwing myself in that group, suffer from perfectionism. Mm-hmm. It can be a blessing and a curse. Mark, would you agree that being a perfectionist is both a blessing and a curse?
Absolutely it is. And, you know, I think that it's becoming more and more clear to me that we need to know when to be a perfectionist and when not to be a perfectionist. Mm-hmm. Instead of saying I am one or I'm not one, rather make it a choice in every situation. For example, if I was a perfectionist and I was a runner, I would just think that I should be able to go out and run a 4-minute mile immediately. But
how's that working for you, Mark?
I can't even run an 8-minute mile, so it doesn't really, it's kind of irrelevant. But when it comes to preparations and crown margins and laboratory communication, all that stuff, man, I am dialed in perfectionist. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to chronic disease management, we have to completely rethink the idea that we can fix people. And we have to start thinking about how can we manage what's going on now in a way that provides them with a little better future. Mm. And we may not be able to prevent them from having a fatal heart attack at the age of 92, but maybe we can get them through their 60s and 70s and 80s. Mm-hmm. In a way that they have the quality of life that they want to have.
I use a term when I'm speaking and also with our clients that I think might be appropriate here, and that's that sometimes it's progress rather than perfection that we're looking for. Does that make sense?
Well, we always need to feel like we're on the road to wellness or to having something be better. But if we get to the destination, then what? You know, so maybe we don't ever really get there, but
it's almost like it's almost like the point on the horizon. You know, if you're out sailing, mm-hmm. and you're sailing to the point, you actually never get there. Mm-hmm. The horizon keeps changing, right?
Right.
It's kind of a cool way to look at goals, you know, that you never really get there. There's somewhere else, you know, to get to in a positive way, as long as you don't beat yourself up about that. But, hey, so let me ask a very direct question, and some of our listeners might be thinking of this. With all the things we need to know in dentistry, why dig, you know, into the topic of airway in the dental practice? With all the other stuff, why airway?
Well, I'm going to start by saying that first of all, in 2017, a year ago, the American Dental Association has mandated that dentists have responsibilities in the areas of airway development and management, sleep-related disordered breathing, snoring, and sleep apnea. So, and in my whole career, I've never really thought of the ADA as being on the leading edge of protocols.
I mean, hey, I was thinking the same thing, Mark. So I was thinking,
if the ADA is moving this initiative forward, are we already behind?
We're already behind. Yeah, exactly.
And then the second thing is that they've gone even farther. And in 2018, ADA had a conference committee on children's health, airway, sleep, breathing, growth, and development. And it's at the point now where the leaders in research from many, many institutions and many countries around the world are recognizing the powerful perspective of sleep and airway on the health of our kids and on the health of our elderly.
So really, maybe it's a time for the whole profession to step up. Maybe past time to really step up. And, you know, when I think of, again, the relationship we have with our patients, this is truly life-changing information. I mean, Mark, I know you can probably tell many case studies after case studies of successful, successfully helping patients manage this. And I can only imagine that it is life-changing for them.
Yeah, I'd like to start by sharing a case study that wasn't successful in my mind. Mm-hmm. And it's very personal. And that is that I was in my treatment room in 1994 at 11:30 in the morning when I got a phone call from my aunt and uncle that my father had died. Mm. And in retrospect, doing retrospective Sherlock Holmes work, as you described it, I found out that he had quit taking his blood pressure medication because he didn't like the side effects of it. And he'd always been a man who had snored deeply, and he had a nocturnal fatal heart attack in the night before. And it kind of rocked me back on my heels. He was 76 years old, which seemed like not so bad when I was younger. Mm-hmm. And now I'm thinking, holy mackerel, you know, 76 is just getting started for some of the people in our institutions, in our government, and our leaders, and in our corporations. You know, the 70s are when a lot of people hit their stride.
Right.
And so in retrospect, I realized that that was a mistake on my part to not have been looking more deeply at him. And then it turned my life around, and I went and got a sleep study done in the 90s and had a very profound experience with the sleep physician then. Right. And it's made a huge difference in my health and my life. And so there are things that happen to us personally that that trigger these things. And I would just caution any of your listeners out there to not assume everything's going to be okay and ignore the warning signs.
Right, right. Yeah, you know, I didn't know that story, Mark, and I can understand the personal impact that had on you with your father. Yeah, absolutely. And you know, we're learning more and more. I mean, I feel like the research and the knowledge is opening up. I mean, one example is Alzheimer's disease, which we're learning more and more every day about it. And learning possible connections.
Yeah. I just want to say that today in Newsweek, there was a published research out of England, I believe, if I remember correctly. And it was about the relationship of Alzheimer's to herpes virus. Mm-hmm. And, you know, as dentists, we deal with herpes virus every single day in our patient population. Maybe it's on an outbreak. Maybe it's just a chronic condition for them. But the herpes virus combined with chronic inflammation and sleep disordered breathing are huge impacts to huge risk factors for Alzheimer's.
Well, Mark, you've got such a unique perspective on this that I want to take a little bit of a deeper dive with you on this. And that's, you know, what can our listeners do to prevent or minimize sleep disordered breathing? I think we now know to ask questions, and we now know to put that detective cap on and incorporate that into our exam process. But what can we do to prevent or minimize sleep disordered breathing?
So this is the $64 question here, which is sleep disordered breathing is a combination of behavioral problems, functional problems, and anatomical problems. So when is the best time for us to deal with the functional, behavioral, and anatomical issues for our patients? It's when they're growing.
Early.
It's the kids, right?
Mm-hmm. So they don't grow into adults with all of these symptoms and signs that we're having to deal with. Mm-hmm. If we start, you know, I know that most orthodontists in the past have recommended to see kids at age 7. Now the research is saying if we get a hold of them at age 3 or 4, we can actually make a bigger difference.
Yeah. So really reevaluate when that first screening appointment should be.
In addition to that, we're seeing that a big push into fetal and maternal health, because women in their third trimester have their diaphragm pretty squished, and their ability to oxygenate that fetus to term is sometimes a problem. Mm-hmm. And we're seeing issues with kids being born with all kinds of obvious disorders like cerebral palsy and things like that. But we also see these kids who are born oxygen deprived, and their development is almost like they're a 6 or 8 week preemie. Mm. Wow. So because of airway. So really our detective work goes early into our patients, which means who's sitting down with a pregnant mom and having a conversation about this. If they happen to be with a on the ball OBGYN nurse practitioner, maybe a little bit, but you know, our dental hygienists see these patients when they're first pregnant, and we talk to them how excited they are to have a baby. But do we then coach that mom through her pregnancy and tell them when we want to see them? And a lot of these issues show up from day one with tongue ties that don't allow the babies to latch, right, and get nutrition. And so we are really, we're really thinking early in terms of creating this. Dee Dee, maybe you want to share a little bit about the functional tongue tie situation for someone growing up and kind of where that ends up down the road. You want to share that?
Yeah. So I actually just went through a tongue tie release at age 47 that I had no idea was in contribution to me not sleeping well. And we traced back, went through all of my history and, you know, back into my childhood of times where I had high anxiety, where I was sleepwalking, where I was not sleeping well. But, you know, at the time we just didn't know that because of the tongue tie that my swallow was not developing, into an adult swallow. And still at 47, I was, you know, I'm in the middle of myofunctional therapy right now, in order to correct that so that, I don't have to wear a CPAP machine. And so I can have a healthier, future. But having that tongue tie, release, it's so crazy. And my tongue had never felt like it. It always felt like it was too big for my mouth. And immediately following the surgery, not only did it fit in my mouth, but I felt relief down my neck and into my chest of tightness and pain that I had been experiencing my whole life. And so if we can get to kids at an early age and, you know, and adults, you know, meet people where they are. Mm-hmm. And there's so many ways that we can help them in, from a prevention standpoint, that they don't have to live with headaches and TMD issues. And sometimes it's as simple as a tongue tie release.
What so. A great personal story, you know, related to this, Dee Dee. Mm-hmm. Hey, Mark, I want to come back to something you said earlier. And I'm going to get on my soapbox for just a minute. Mm-hmm. You know, and you said, you know, where are these conversations happening? Are they happening at the physician's office? Are they happening at the OBGYN's office? And I'm going to get on my insurance soapbox for just a minute that if their physicians are involved in managed care, as the vast majority of them are, they get an average of about 4 to 5 minutes per patient visit with the patient, sadly. You know, I'll share some data with you, Mark and Dee Dee, that the average general practitioner physician sees 80 to 100 patients a day. And if, and just do the math, if it's 80 patients a day, you know, divided by an 8-hour day, they get 6 minutes with every patient. So I think it's fairly safe to say we can't assume that this is happening somewhere else. This conversation is happening somewhere else, because if it's on the medical side, it probably isn't happening. You know, Mark and Dee Dee, you both know that I lost my parents in the last 5 years, lost my mother 5 years ago and my dad a year later, 4 years ago. And I went through, you know, as the oldest son, I went through all of their healthcare appointments with them. And it was really sad to see how the medical profession has degraded into a transaction of 4 or 5 minutes with the patient. Very sad to see. And I'd like to suggest as a profession in dentistry, we don't have to go down that path. And we can maintain a very personal relationship with the patients and give them the time that they need. And give them the time that allows you to be a proper detective and find these things. Obviously it requires some training, and some behavioral training that we're going to get into in just a minute, Dee Dee, with some of your skills. But I'd like to suggest that we probably shouldn't assume that it's going to happen at the physician's office, because it may not, given the nature of managed care in healthcare.
Well, Gary, the way I think about it is, in a dental practice, even some of the managed care dental practices, we have dental hygienists who spend an hour or 40 minutes or whatever with a patient every 4 to 6 months. Now, that amount of time, and yes, they have some tasks to do and so forth, but how many physicians schedule time every 4 to 6 months for their patients to come in and see their dietitian or their range of motion specialist or their fitness trainer? How many physicians build that in to their healthcare practice to have a preventive mindset and a coaching mindset for their patients?
Oh, you're absolutely right. I mean, it's just not happening, and yet there's an appetite for it, isn't there, on the consumer side?
Most definitely, it's a commitment to overall wellness. And like you were talking about earlier, Gary, when you go to doctor's appointments with elderly parents, it's, we have to be our own biggest advocate in those kind of situations, because the medical model is broken from a perspective of it is reactionary. You know, when you have 6 minutes, you don't have time to get into goals and values and history and, you know, overall wellness and prevention. But we absolutely do in the dental office. And, you know, from an education standpoint, our doctors are head and neck doctors. They're not just tooth doctors. Mm-hmm. And it's our job as a team to educate our patients that the things that we can see in the mouth are signs and symptoms of bigger things going on in the rest of their body. And the fact that we take the time to listen, to slow down, and to monitor closely, we have a great entry point into really making a huge impact in our community.
And talk about, you know, just professional satisfaction, right?
It increases that so much.
And doctors, if you're listening to this and you're feeling like you're that rat on the treadmill with your, you know, dental PPO plans, go back and listen to my episode on busting loose from insurance dependence. I don't mean to be self-serving with that recommendation, but go back and listen to that. Listen to how in my own practice, we successfully went out of network with 34 PPO plans, 34. When we bought the practice, it had 34 PPO plans. Mark, I didn't know there were 34 PPO plans in Arizona. We couldn't get them to work with the quality of care we wanted to provide. And over a period of time, we successfully resigned. And when I say successfully, let me quantify that for you. We kept 84% of our in-network patients when we went out of network. So it can be done. And we've done this with practices all over the country, and we've had even greater success than that. Recently, we went back and did the metrics on an office that went through a similar transformation, a client of ours, and this practice maintained 88% of their in-network patients when they went out of network. And I think this topic is one that's going to help you with that, because when you're slowing down and you're talking to patients and you're getting information from them, they aren't having those experiences at a PPO clinic. And I'm telling you, the people have an appetite for this today. It's a point of differentiation. I mean, pardon me for getting on the soapbox, but,
No, I'm 100% on your team on that, and I would highly recommend that people go back and listen to that as well. It's incredibly motivating and informative. And if our business is being dictated by this PPO model, this 6 minute per patient model, it's like Dee Dee said, we never get to dig in. We can't sit down with a hygiene patient and compare the chronic inflammation, their blood sugar, their blood pressure, their herpes virus, their sleep history. We can't do that unless we build a model that allows that to happen. And that's what Dee Dee and I love to do, is build strategic models that allow dentists to practice the way they want to practice, that makes the biggest impact on their patient's health. In fact, Dee Dee, you've even hired treatment coordinators and health coaches to help patients outside of what the doctor's duties are. Is that correct?
Yes, and I highly recommend that. Doctors don't necessarily have the time to have the conversations with patients that I have had over the years. When patients telling me that they want to live until they're 100, and my question to them is, well, how do you want to live out your last 25 years? Do you want to be healthy and vital, or do you want to struggle with health issues? Because we can help manage that from a wellness mindset. But if we don't ask those questions, how deep can we go? And then that is transformational for our patients and very satisfying.
I have a new mentor, Mark and Dee Dee, who's come into my life in the last year, and that's Peter Diamandis. You might recognize his name, Peter Diamandis. And one of his areas of interest is longevity. And Peter is a Harvard-educated MD, founder of XPRIZE, by the way. So if you ever want to Google him, just Google him. He's written two amazing books, both New York Times bestseller. One of them is titled Abundance, and the other is titled Bold. He chooses one word titles for his book. So one of them's titled Abundance and one's titled Bold. And Peter is absolutely convinced that we are on the cusp of radical increase in longevity. And and to think that we could live to 150 years old, that the three of us could each live to be 150 or older is actually not a stretch. And then Peter always asks, well, how do you want those last 25 years? How do you want to live? And guess what everyone says? You already know what everyone says.
Healthy, vital, strong.
Exactly. So how do you, you're so good at, you're like a master communicator. How do you discuss disease risks with patients? How do you open up those conversations?
Well, you do it so well. It's a mindset of curiosity. I have a natural curiosity to know more about people, because people are fascinating. And, asking deeper questions upon deeper questions. And I don't know, it's something that I do naturally, but it's stuff that Mark and I teach in, training treatment coordinators and hygienists and teams in getting in with our patients, slowing down, taking the time to listen and focus. And because it's not about us, it's all about them. So asking questions
and listening.
I loved your characterization of yourself as being curious and curiosity. I think that descriptive is what makes an awesome treatment coordinator. Of course, there's many other elements of a treatment coordinator, but I think to train yourself. So sometimes we have that naturally. I like to think that I'm naturally curious, but sometimes it's there naturally. But it can also be developed as well. But I love the way you pinpointed the value of curiosity, and that goes for our doctors as well. Being curious and asking questions. And taking time to listen. Well, hey, I want to bridge over to what you guys are doing. You guys are doing some super cool things with helping dentists develop their airway practice within their practice. Tell our listeners about some of the cool things you're doing these days.
Well, probably the most fun things we love to do are bringing systems and protocols into the dental practice that focus on the doctor's vision, designing the practice to have the practice of your dreams any way you want it. And then we put together the blueprint and the system so that we can have it turn out. But systems have to have a way to communicate. It's not just the checklist. Mm-hmm. You've got to be able to communicate not only with our patients, but with our team. And so getting a higher level of knowledge and greater empathy in the care that we are providing to, you know, our community at large. So, you know, being able to fulfill that ADA mandate and increase the quality of life for our patients and our teams, we're playing an important role in making that impact in the patient's overall health. And so systems.
You're speaking my language, Dee Dee. And, you know, I might suggest, too, that for many practices, we could probably start with the team, couldn't we? Because when we think about, you know, Mark, you were sharing early at the top of the interview about some of the comorbidities and some of the things that we see. And, you know, I imagine that if you're a doctor that has, you know, 8 or 10 team members, it statistically, it's likely that some of those issues are going on with our team members. I think that's a pretty safe assumption, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, some of the most common ones, especially in dentistry, has to do with chronic pain and headaches. And people who have chronic pain don't sleep very well. And so that creates a sleep disturbance with all of the issues that go along with that. When you sleep, about 70% of your sleep should be resting your body, should be restoring your body. And about 25 or 30% of your sleep is to restore your brain. And if you don't get good sleep, if you are in pain, your brain can't heal. And so we really have to take an opportunity to dig in and what's going on just with our teams. And one of my favorite things that I've learned is that we have a tendency to think that we're being curious when we say things like, "So, do you have headaches?" And that is not curious.
That makes it too easy just to say no.
That's like you're just checking a box on a form. You know, I want
not personal.
Well, role play. Can I put you on the spot, Mark?
Sure.
Role play with me as a patient. Role play a better way to have that conversation. And I'll play the role of a patient, assuming that I had these issues. So go ahead.
So Gary, tell me a little bit about the work you do, the style of work you do, and how you spend your days.
Mark, I got the coolest job in the world. I get to work with dentists and dental professionals and help them develop their ideal practice.
Oh, that's awesome. And how do you do that? Like in a normal day, tell me about your hours and your body position and your movement and that.
Well, I will confess to you that I'm a workaholic. I spend a lot of time working. I do love what I do, but I spend an awful lot of time working. When I'm traveling, I'm up and about and visiting practices. But when I'm in the office, it's often a stationary position in front of my computer.
Right. Right. I'm just curious. Could you just share with me, on a daily basis, how many days out of a week would you say that you wake up in the morning feeling fantastic?
That's a good question. Less than half.
Yeah. And on the days when you feel less than fantastic, how do you get past that and get into your day with the energy that you love to project?
Well, you know, I'm a runner, and so I start my day off with a long run in the morning, and often feel I'm usually running by 4:30. I do that to beat the heat, you know, in Phoenix in the summer, but I stick with that schedule year round. And, you know, I like to think that it's that vigorous workout that sort of kicks everything in gear.
Cool. So when you're running, do you run, to breathlessness, to being out of breath, or do you run pretty low cardio, like a aerobic pace? Or
I actually have a regular workout routine that varies from oxygen deprivation, you know, as hard as I can, to lighter days where it's a matter of maintaining a regular heart rate. So it's a varied. Running schedule.
Interesting. So, you know, when you run hard and you do some of your anaerobic stuff to push yourself, you know how when you get out of breath and you feel like you need more oxygen, right? You know what that feels like to you.
Yeah. So this morning,
if that was happening unconsciously when you were sleeping, do you feel like your body would be rested and feeling fantastic in the morning?
Oh, not at all. I imagine that's the half the time when I wake up and I don't feel rested.
So would it make sense to you if we took a look at those half of the days that are not getting you restored and see if we can figure out what might be happening at night, so that we could have more days of you waking up feeling fantastic?
Oh man, I'm in with both feet on this one, Mark. Hey Mark, just a little aside, indeed, you'd be interested in this. I spoke recently at a Smiles at Sea cruise, and it was the Alaska cruise, right? And I wanted to maintain my workout schedule and running, you know, on the cruise. So I would go into the gym at the ship in the morning. I'd be in there at 5 a.m. I was the only one in there other than Trish O'Hare. Trish O'Hare was in there with me at 5 a.m. And she came up to me on the first morning and she's looking at me and she goes, you know, you're not a mouth breather normally, but do you know that you breathe through your mouth when you're under exertion?
Wow.
And I'm like, well, now that you mention it, yeah. And she goes, would you like to stop doing that? Because I already knew the benefits of nose breathing and I knew I could get 18% more oxygen. I'm immediately translating that into performance, right? So I said, yes. So she said, I could do something real quick that would help you with that. And anyway, she reaches into her gym bag and she pulls out tape. And literally, she taped my mouth shut. I was the hostage runner. Okay. I looked, but no one else was in the gym. So I said, what the heck? And you know, so she said, I did that for three workouts in a row at the gym. And then she said, do it for a week at home. And she goes, you run at 4:30 in the morning. No one's outside. It won't bother anybody. I said, sure. And you know that I improved my average, on my long runs, I'm talking about 8-10 mile runs, I improved my mile pace by 30 seconds, my average mile pace by 30 seconds by retraining myself to breathe through my nose instead of through my mouth.
That's the first confidence, Gary, in airway health is getting to nasal breathing. And, you know, we've got, there's a lot of studies out now that professional athletes are looking at how they are breathing to get into peak performance. There's also studies in helping military mm-hmm. that have PTSD, and it focuses on the breathing pattern, respiratory patterns, in how much oxygen that you're intaking, but also how much CO2 is that you, so that people aren't over breathing,
right?
Over inhalation. Right. And so lip taping sounds crazy and weird, but it's a common thing in an airway focused practice that we actually recommend for patients. And, because it's helping to retrain the neural pathways of the brain to breathe properly when you're sleeping, if you're doing some of that during the day.
Wow. You know, and Mark, I want to come back to your role playing, and I just want to recognize how well you were just steering the conversation with questions that you have genuine interest in. So I'm going to put both of you on the spot for just a minute. Could I get you both back on the show? And I have a specific, I want to take this topic and I want to take it to a deeper level. And here's what I would like to do. Would you, both of you, put together a couple of case studies of the impact that this is making on practices? And could we bring you back on the show to talk about those case studies? And obviously we'll need permission from your clients, but could we share that information with our listeners so that they can understand? I look at this as kind of the view from 30,000 feet today, and I'd like to really get granular and have you come back and talk about some case studies and the impact that it's making on their practices and the impact that it's making on their lives as healthcare providers. Could we do that?
Absolutely.
Somehow I thought you might say yes to that.
Yes.
Hey, so I just learned that you are opening up a very cool Facebook group. What a great platform for that. It's called the Airway Dentist. Mark, tell our listeners what you have in mind for that.
Yeah, you know, I think we just need a place for people who are intrigued or interested or dabbling or even wrestling with some of the changes that go along with putting airway systems into practice. I guess my favorite people are the ones who are curious. So I would love people to come and be curious and ask questions, and we plan on posting interviews with some of the leading airway lecturers and leaders in dentistry and in medicine. Mm-hmm. And we're also going to, from time to time, we'll just post intriguing little blogs posts and articles that show up in the research and things that give the airway dentist an opportunity to kind of have a home, not so much to argue about how they do everything, but a place to really refresh themselves with a little bit of knowledge and a little bit of encouragement and some of Dee Dee's magic of communication skills.
Well, fun. That's what we're all about.
I want all of our listeners to jump on that Facebook group. It's called the Airway Dentist. I'm going to put a link to it in the show notes. So if you're driving, don't take your hands off the wheel. Simply go to thrivingdentist.com and scroll down the page. You'll see all the show notes. Click the Facebook link and you can join their group. It's an open group. And I'd like to think that all of our listeners want to learn more about becoming an airway dentist. So what a great way to do that. I also want to share your website address for all of our listeners, because your website's amazing. There's so much cool information on there. And if you haven't visited as a listener, I want you to visit Mark and Dee Dee's website. It's called AmplifiedDynamics.com. Amplified Dynamics. Again, I'll put that in the show notes so you can click and go right to their website. And then Mark and Dee Dee, would it be okay if our listeners reached out to you personally? Would that be okay if they did that via email?
Yes, we'd love it.
And again, very simple. Dee Dee, at amplifieddynamics.com and Mark at amplifieddynamics.com. I'm going to put that in the show notes so that you can just click and go directly to their email. But if you haven't figured out that Mark and Dee Dee are beyond amazing resources, then you haven't been listening. But they are incredible, and they need to be in your close lists of contacts. Mark, I love you guys and appreciate all that you do and the amazing passion that you bring to our profession. Mark, every time we're together, and we get the opportunity to be together a number of times during the year at major meetings, every time we get together, I leave our interactions with information I didn't know before and deeper curiosity about things that you have directed me to. So I just want to take a minute and say thanks. And Dee Dee, every time I'm with you, I feel like I elevate my communication because I want to be like Dee Dee. So thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for having us, Gary.
Thank you so much, Gary. It's been a blast. And as usual, I could talk shop with you anytime.
Well, we're going to get you back and we'll do some case studies and we'll leave that as a teaser for our listeners because that'll be incredible. Hey, I want to take a minute and thank our listeners. We sure appreciate each and every one of you here at the Thriving Dentist Show. There's three things you can do to support our work. Number one, you can tell a colleague, as many dentists have never heard the word podcast. Tell them about podcasts and tell them about the Thriving Dentist Show. Second thing you can do is you can jump on iTunes and write us a review. A review on iTunes helps more dentists find us. And the third thing that you can do is you can hit the subscribe button. You can do that on iTunes. You can do that on Google Play or whatever your podcast directory of choice is. Just hit subscribe. That means every Wednesday when we upload a new show, it'll automatically be uploaded to your listening device. You'll never miss a future show. On that note, let me take a minute and thank you for the privilege of your time and tell you I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes. Better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide. And don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big. As big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.